The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... In. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. We think today we live in an era of revolutions. Spin the globe, and there's hardly a quarter of it that is not the scene of insurrection and bloodshed. A new tyranny to take the place of the old. The rights of man proclaimed and abused, always in the name of the rights of man. The great writer Honoré de Balzac has drawn from the French Revolution the picture of a man so haunted by death and tortured by guilt that he gave his life to save his soul.
You think there is really someone following you? Well, there are shadows and there are shadows. In these times, it could be imagination.
I don't know, Simon. All today and yesterday, at the foot of the stairs in the courtyard, there was someone. Someone unfamiliar, sinister, like a animal hunted. You can tell who is the hunter.
Our mystery drama, Episode of the Terror, based on the story by Honoré de Balzac, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by G. Frederick Lewis and stars Marian Seldes. I shall return shortly with Act One. January 1793. Anarchy rules France, disguised as the Committee for Public Safety. The River Seine is stained with red. Thousands lie dying in their beds, in the streets, and under the guillotine. No one can be trusted. Everyone is a spy. It is the reign of terror. Honoré de Balzac begins his story on a snowy January night as a woman hurries through the streets of Paris. He writes,
as she walked, she thought she could hear the heavy tread of a man walking behind her. She tried to walk faster. Were they the same footsteps she had heard yesterday? When she arrived at the baker's shop, she stood in the lighted window and slowly dared turn her head. Was there someone there? In the shadows, a man watching her.
Oh, let me sit down a moment.
Good evening, Sister Marguerite.
Out there, someone.
You were followed.
I think so. I'm not sure. Do you have them, Simon? Are they ready?
Well, you look white as snow. Have you been running?
Right, it must have been my imagination. Let me have what I came for, and then I'll go.
Oh, what a time we live in. With you, sister, a world of sin. How is our good father?
He blesses you for what you are doing. And all those who come to us to pray, Simon, they bless you, too.
I never thought the day would come when the churches of France are closed by edict, when a priest has to say a mass in secret, when prayer is punished by death.
I'm expected back. I must go.
Oh, you keep looking through the store window. There's no one out there. All of Paris is at home.
Or dead. Or dying.
I am the only one up. A baker has to bake at night. One cannot have bread in the morning otherwise. What is more, I am all alone now.
But what happened to your assistant, Panto?
Well, he thought he would make more money selling small cakes to the crowds at the guillotine.
Oh, horrible.
Like a ghoul, I told him, selling refreshments as the knife falls. Oh, I'm so ashamed of Pantin.
Did you say you had them ready?
Oh, yes, yes. I have to go to the back. It is not the kind of pastry one can leave lying about.
Simon, let me give you this. Gold, Louis. The price agreed on.
Oh, sister, you did not have to give it to me this instant. Thank you.
Oh, no!
Sister! Oh, Lord in heaven. She has fainted. Sister, wake up, wake up. Oh, what am I going to do? Water. Yes, that's what. I'll get water. Sister, please wake up. Oh, may the Lord forgive me for what I am going to do, but I cannot just let her lie there.
Oh! What was it?
Forgive me, sister. You had fainted. I had to wake you. Let me help you up. Oh. Now, I want you to sit down, please.
Thank you. There was a shadow standing right outside your window. I could see between where you have the wax fruit and the plaster wedding cake.
What do you mean, a shadow?
He's still there. Sister, you are perfectly safe here.
I shan't give you away. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'll go fetch what you purchased. I'll be right back.
Wait, no, I'll come with you. I don't want you to be in any danger either, Simon.
Well, how am I in danger? I don't know anything about it. You ordered some little bread. I made some, or I didn't make some. Either way, I'll take this little cardboard box. They're inside.
Thank you, Simon.
Take it quickly. Hide it inside your cloak.
There.
I can't let you go out into the snow like this.
It stopped snowing.
Well, nevertheless, I have some broth cooking. Take a cupful. That'll keep the chill away. Do you think there was really someone following you? There are shadows, and there are shadows. In these times, it could be imagination.
No, I don't think so. All today and yesterday, at the foot of the stairs in the courtyard, and then on the street, there was someone unfamiliar and sinister. We are only human, but we know. Like an animal hunted. You can tell who is the hunter.
If there is someone out there, he could also be a robber or a thief. I'll put on my saber right over my apron. After all, am I not with the National Guard? You see? How do I look?
Huh?
Oh, sister, you didn't take any of the broth?
No, I want to go back to the front of the shop. I want to have another look through the window.
Oh, the snow has started again. I don't see anyone out there.
Father Laurent is waiting for me. I must go. I don't want you to come with me, Simon. With that saber over your apron, you just attract attention.
Well, I offered. I can't do more than that. I offered.
So you did. I shall tell the father.
No. Not by the front door, sister. Behind the ovens. I'll show you. There's a little door. It leads to an alley which goes straight to the street. Just to be safe.
Thank you, Simon.
Au revoir. Until the next time.
If there is one.
In her bonnet and black cloak, she eventually reached her corner. He was there, across the street. Tall, frightening. Her old terrors awoke. She slipped through the shadows of the door to her house, pressed a spring, and vanished inside.
Father, we must hide. I was followed. We're being watched.
By who?
A man who's been prowling in the yard all day. I saw him yesterday, too, and early this morning. He followed me. I hate them. I hate them.
Sister Marguerite, those are not God's words. Don't let your fear stir emotions you have renowned.
I'm sorry, Father. I'm so frightened.
No. I feel we are safe in this house. Even the stairs to this garret are hidden.
Isn't it enough? They've stripped the church. They've stolen the relics, the bell.
No. Look at it this way. The reign of terror is sent as a trial to us to see how strong our faith is.
They're mad, all of them.
Yes, there I agree with you. One cannot run after freedom by chasing away God. But we will continue to say the Mass every Sunday. You brought the wafers for the communion?
Oh, here in this box. Someone on the stairs. Father, there's no safe place in these two rooms to hide you. Stop now. He's somewhere downstairs. Why is That man walking around like that. Which floor is he on?
I shall put the wafers and our holy objects out of his reach. Give me the box. I climb out the window onto the roof.
Oh, no, you could fall.
Sister, you will do as I say. Now, you will hand to me all the holy relics I saved from the abbey. Now, once I have placed those safely up there, I'll hold out my hand to you, and you can climb out also. So, if this room is being searched, there will be no one here.
But supposing Simon told him where I live?
You don't trust Simon?
Well, they have ways of forcing one to talk. He could be forced to say Sister Marie lives in a garret at the end of the Rue Saint Martin. He's practically outside the door. I'll stay and stop him. Let me open the window for you, Father. Now, here, take the platters and the chalice.
Very well.
Are you safe up there, Father?
Yes. Yes, I can hold on easily. Back on the window when he is gone.
Here.
Close the window.
I'm coming. What do you want?
Let me come in.
I am a woman alone. What is it you wish?
I must talk with you. Let me come in. I will sit here by the window. I ask you to do the same.
I prefer to remain standing. What do you want?
You have been aware I wished to speak to you yesterday?
No, I do not know that.
You did not know I have been watching from your yard since midday yesterday. That this morning and tonight I followed you? You went to the bakery.
Oh, yeah, that. Well, you see, I haven't much bread left, and so I went to ask him if I could have a small loaf.
And what did he tell you?
What did he tell me? He said I could have a small loaf, but he had not baked any last night, and that if I came by tomorrow, he'd keep one for me.
For a small loaf of bread, he would sell you tomorrow. You gave him a gold louis in advance.
A gold louis? How did you know?
I have very good eyesight. I have also very good insight. Sister.
You know.
I am not your enemy. If anything should happen to you, it would not be because of me. I have come to ask a favor.
You have been prowling and following and frightening me for 2 days, and you ask of me a favor? I am alone. What favor can I do for a man?
I may be of service to you.
Who are you?
Do not be afraid. I am the one person who is now above the law. The only one. Since there is no king anymore.
Lord, have mercy on him.
You have prayed for him since his death.
You know too much.
You are giving shelter in this garret to a reverend father who refused to renounce and escape from the Carmelite Abbey, who escaped from the massacres there by a miracle.
There's no priest here.
Then you should be more careful. Last Sunday, a number of people climbed these stairs to take part in a mass. Masses are forbidden. Tomorrow, there will be others who will climb the stairs. Sister Marguerite, you see, I know your name, and also that of your honored guest, Father Laurent.
All is lost.
If I had ever thought of betraying you to the Committee for Public Safety, I could have done so long ago. Open the window, sister.
I heard. The roof, like the walls of these two rooms, are of paper.
I am glad the snow has stopped, Father. I would not want you to catch a cold when so much depends upon your health.
Monsieur, you have the advantage over me. Who are you?
Please don't ask me, so that I will not have to refuse you an answer. Did you hear me tell Sister Marguerite that if I can do anything for you, not to be afraid to make use of me?
You are not one of our persecutors. I believe that. I trust you. But what is it you came here for?
I have come to beg you to celebrate a mass for the repose of of the soul of an august person whose body will never rest in consecrated earth.
A mass for one such as that?
A child of God, nonetheless.
Yes. Come back here at midnight. I shall be ready to celebrate the only funeral service the church can offer such a soul. Why is he not buried in consecrated earth?
I can see that you have led a very sheltered life in this garret. Like all Christians, he wished such a burial, but he had not the power to have his will obeyed.
Well, come at midnight.
This was the reign of terror, when every shadow on the wall, every glance, every look, every wink of an eye could mean betrayal. In a diary of the day, it says, "None had dreamt of establishing a system of terror. It established itself. No one will organized it, but everyone's will contributed to its creation." I shall return shortly with Act Two. Was a dark period in man's history. The atmosphere so unreal that even the months of the year were given new names. The guillotine rose and fell like a trip hammer. Yet, in spite of it all, or probably because of it, people crept up to that garret and prayed to their God for deliverance. Honoré de Balzac picks up the scene in his own words.
2 hours later, a great ivory and ebony crucifix hung on the bare wall of the garret. 4 altar candles gave a faint, pale light, like a ray from heaven shining on the makeshift altar. Nothing could be less imposing, nor more solemn. Is everything in place, Sister Marguerite?
Everything except the chalice.
You'll bring that out when it is time,
Do you trust that man, Father?
Well, a man has thought to say a mass for the burial of the dead. You can be suspicious.
Could it be a trap?
Well, if it is, we shall arrive sooner in heaven than I had planned. Either way, we are rewarded.
I believe he's honest. To go to the trouble to find this insignificant corner of the church, to say a mass for the dead. He must be a good man.
Well, I suspect he's someone's great friend.
I wonder how he escaped the guillotine.
Let us be ready when he arrives. Good evening.
Good evening, sister. Good evening, father.
Shall we begin, my son?
I shall kneel at the altar.
Sister, will you fetch the chalice? I am the resurrection and the life, saith the Lord. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
O God, whose mercies cannot be numbered, accept our prayers on behalf of the soul of thy servant departed, and grant him an entrance into the land of light and joy, and the fellowship of thy saints.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive those who trespass against us.
And forgive those responsible for the regicide, for death of kings, as Louis himself forgave them.
Lord, have mercy on us. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Father, Laurent.
Yes, I know, sister. The man is weeping. The mass is over.
Father, it is written, is it not, that Man is born of woman and has but a short time to live.
Yes, my son.
But his life is full of misery.
In the midst of life, we are in death.
I must leave. It is time. Here, for your pain.
Oh, no. No money, please.
For the poor, then. I shall leave it on the table.
Sister, take care of this purse. Tomorrow we will buy bread for those who are without.
Oh, this will last a long time.
Now I must go.
I wish to ask you something, monsieur.
What is it?
Will you tell me your name?
The name will tell you nothing. I am grateful for the burial mass. And now let me ask you. Would you say it could bring peace even to the soul of a king?
If you have faith, my son, would you not like me to hear your confession?
What do you think I have to confess?
Why, that is not up to me. You know better than I. If your hands are stained with blood of the royal martyr, confide in me.
What would the Lord think of the man who betrayed a Christian?
Oh, there is no sin the Savior will not forgive.
Father, I swear to you, there is no one less guilty than I of bloodshed.
Is that true?
I said I swear it.
It is not enough to have taken no part in a great crime. That fact does not absolve you. The man who might have defended the king and left their swords in their scabbards will have a heavy account to render to the King of Heaven.
I suppose so.
For by doing nothing, they have become accomplices in this awful wickedness.
There is punishment, then, even for those who indirectly...
What was it Cain said to the Lord when the Lord asked him, "Where is your brother Abel?"
Cain said, I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper?
There is your answer. We are our brother's keeper.
Thank you again for your prayers, and you too, sister.
Pray for our protection, and we will pray for yours.
I can do a little more than pray for your safety. The house you're living in belongs to Mucius Savola. He's thought to be a new patriot, but in reality, his heart is with the Bourbons. He used to be a huntsman serving the Prince de Conti. I have talked to him, and he assures me that so long as you remain in his house, you are safe.
But we may have to sell some of the relics rescued from l'Abbaye to obtain money to give to the poor.
No more. Money will be brought to you. Wait here in safety for better times. Father, I have with me a holy relic, and I ask you to take it. Guard it. It's priceless. When I have gone, you will understand better why I have asked you for this mass.
Will you come here again?
Next year, on the 21st of January, if you are still in the same place, I will come back and ask you to celebrate another mass for the repose of the king's soul and for the forgiveness of my sins. Au revoir.
What a strange man he is.
He is not so much strange as broken. And he came to you to be healed.
My daughter, have you lived long enough to have seen a broken man?
I have, yes. My brother Alain, a young student. 6 months ago, he was in a street in Saint-Germain-des-Prés. And he saw a mob stop the carriages filled with prisoners. And they pulled out a man and woman and cut them down without mercy. And suddenly Alain saw a boyhood friend, still in his dressing gown, being attacked. He saw Alain and cried out, "Alain, help me." My brother ran away. He ran and he ran. But from that day his mind has never caught up with his body.
That is sad, but I don't think our visitor has lost his mind.
No, but there's pain. He reminded me so much of Alain, who is also tall.
Did he die?
I don't know if he is dead or alive. How can one in these terrible times? He wanders about Paris like in Dante's Inferno. Are you going to open that box you were given?
Ah, yes, yes. What is this? A handkerchief?
Oh, it's so knotted and crumpled. This is very fine linen. Look, Father, there in the corner. Isn't that the royal crown?
Yes.
Could I hold it? These stains. What do you suppose they are?
Those are blood.
Citizen, citizen, forgive me, but is this the Place Louis XV?
No more it is. Do not you know its new name?
No, I wasn't told.
Place de la Révolution.
Oh, well, why are so many people here? What is everyone looking at over there?
The guillotine, of course. Where are you from?
The moon? Oh, no, I don't know where I'm from. I'm sorry.
Hey. Why do you look at me like that? Are you all right, young man?
Something made me run away. They were killing him and I ran away. He will hate me forever for that now, won't he?
You should not be here. You have to have a strong stomach for this.
I ran away. That is all I remember.
Eh? You know your name?
Oh, yes. Yes, yes. I'm Alain Robert. My sister Marguerite is a nun. She wanted to take care of me, but I had to go.
Alain Robert, I do not think you are very close in the head. I advise you to go home. You are not well.
And I don't know where I live anymore. I have forgotten the street.
Young man, stay away from the Place de la Révolution. Go find your sister. You need taking care of.
Father Laurent, is that you? Is that you? You know you're not supposed to leave this. Who are you?
Do not be afraid, Sister Marguerite. Close the door.
I'm not Sister Marguerite. What gave you such an idea?
Let me assure you, I am a friend. My name is Pantin. I sell lemonade and cakes and rolls in the streets. I am a Frenchman, not a citizen. You have nothing to fear from me.
How did you find me?
It's Simone, the baker, where I get my cakes and bread to sell. He told me tonight. I asked him if he knew a nun called Sister Marguerite. I used to be Simone's assistant. I missed the flower in the back. You never saw me, Simone. Said you and Father Laurent say mass.
You wish to come to mass here next Sunday?
Do you have a brother called Alain?
Yes, I do.
First crack out of the musket, and I have found his sister. It grieves me to tell you.
He's dead.
How did you know?
It was bound to happen. He went out of his mind when he saw his best friend attacked and killed by a mob. He came to me once, but then he disappeared.
I met Alain by accident.
He was sent to the guillotine? But what had he done?
I do not know. You do not need to have done anything these days. They pulled him out of a cart with 20 others.
And what are they doing? Alain is not royalty. He was a student.
It does not matter who you are.
You said your name was Panta?
Yes.
Thank you for finding me. We will kneel together and pray for the souls of those departed. And for you also. It is never too late to begin anew.
The feeling of dread, the terror beneath which France was groaning in those days, weighed down the hours. However, soon those who kept faith alive in that tiny garret knew that a powerful hand of protection was extended over them. The mystery that hung about the stranger grew inexplicable. As for the priest, he did not even try to understand it.
With those words, Honoré de Balzac completes the first part of his story. The priest had escaped from the massacre at the Carmelite Abbey, where murders were committed in the name of freedom. Freedom and justice. What sins have been committed in thy name? Cried the author of our story. And we who have lived in the decades since know how true that is. I shall return shortly with Act Three. Curtain rises on the horror that engulfed the city of Paris in the 1790s. We ask ourselves today, were these forces too powerful to be controlled by men? A whirlwind of death that swept aside every feeling of humanity that ever existed in man. Against this backdrop of the Great Terror, Honoré de Balzac focuses a spotlight upon one little garret in Paris.
Yes, a guardian angel seemed to be protecting Sister Marguerite and Father Law. Firewood and provisions appeared mysteriously. Many silently came to pray. What new surprise would the next morning bring? A kind of cult sprang up about the stranger. And so a year passed.
Father, I noticed the candles in your room were burning very late last night.
I was saying some extra prayers for the stranger.
I thought you might be. I always say mine in the dark.
It is one day to 12 months since he was here. And the terror continues.
Will it ever end, Father?
Ever? Oh, yes. Now the queen has followed the king into the grave. Those who ordered the murder, the Robespierre, the Saint-Just, the Coutons, they will follow. Those who live by the sword.
I know, die by the sword. But I cannot look that far ahead. I can think only of tomorrow.
Because it is the 21st of January.
Yes, I'm so afraid he won't come. Or perhaps he's not even in France and cannot come.
Perhaps. Was there something special you wanted to ask me tonight?
No, I've disturbed you enough. I'm sorry.
No, you were downstairs today. You visited Madame de Champs again. How is she?
Oh, she's afraid all the time. She misses her husband. We read the poetry of André Chenier together. She knew him, you know.
Oh, I didn't. I knew he was put to death.
Yes, but all a mistake. They thought he was his brother, Sauveur Chenier. And then, well, they think it's some clerical error. We'd better kill them both.
Sister, try not to dwell on the evils of the day.
I try not to. Anyway, Madame Deschamps has a friend, who also a widow, who lives next door in the front apartment, and I promised to visit her as well. They'll both come here for next Sunday Mass.
Well, the more the merrier, I always say.
Oh, Father, Father. How you keep your sense of humor in these days, I will never know.
Well, I am merely exercising one of God's blessings.
Simone, believe me, I am glad I am not spending my days on the streets anymore. I have been shown the light.
I will say baking bread is a more honorable profession than selling cakes to the demented.
Huh?
If you don't walk so fast, Pantheon, you draw attention to yourself.
Oh, but we must get across the Place de la Révolution before the afternoon crowd gathers. It can happen in the winking of an eye. You don't know, Simone. You are at the ovens. You have not been abroad like I have. Once the people get word there's an execution, the side streets are so clogged, you cannot get through.
You sure we can buy flour from your friend?
Ah, I am sure. Ah, that is what I was afraid of. You know what day it is today, Simone, don't you?
The 21st of January.
What happened right here 1 year ago at noon? Louis says, lost his head.
I can't remember. Had he arrived last time as the clock began striking 12 midnight? or after it had struck.
Sister, why haven't you lit all the altar candles?
No, I lit only four because I wanted to look the way it did a year ago. All we could afford then was those four little candles.
Light all 12. Oh. Whether our friend arrives or not, we still have much to be thankful for. We have food, the rent is paid, more and more come to mass. All mysteriously happening.
You're not so mysterious. We know who makes it happen. I'm sure it's him. I know. You see, Father? You see?
My son, you are welcome. Do come in.
We were expecting you. Please let me take your coat. Excuse me, I must light 8 more candles. I'll only be a minute.
Everything is ready for the mass.
Father, before we begin, one question.
Certainly.
You have not been outside this house since I was last here.
You were kind enough to warn us. We have never gone out.
Good. Then let us pray.
It was the strangest thing, wasn't it, Father? He hardly said a word after you finished the mass. He looked around once, took his coat and left. Not a word. He acted like a complete stranger. He was so cold. So very cold.
Well, he has done all any human can do for another, and we have done for him what he asked. There is no more.
He didn't even say he would see us again.
Tomorrow is another day, sister. Child, there are tears in your eyes. It wasn't meant to be.
What wasn't meant to be?
We have met a very good man, and that is about it.
I thought of him only as a lost soul who needed our prayers. And I wanted him to know how much we appreciated what he has done. I can't go on, Father. Forgive me.
If our friend did not wish to speak to us, if he does not ever see us again, I know we have helped him as he has helped us.
It isn't a personal thing the way I feel. Not at all. I wanted to ask him, was that really the king's handkerchief he gave us? How did he get it? I wanted him to know he would be welcome here at any time. Just walk up the stairs and knock on the door. How could it be?
Oh, sister, you are up. The hour isn't too late. I've just heard the most wonderful news. May I come in?
Yes, come in, Simon. What news?
I shan't stay a minute. Pantin can't manage the ovens alone, and we're baking a very large order for bread tomorrow.
Well, did you get the flour?
Oh, it's just it. That's why I'm here. It is the end. I mean the beginning of the end. The killers are being killed. The millers are milling wheat. One can actually buy flour legally. Tomorrow people will be able to walk the streets in safety.
It is over. The terror.
Yeah, well, some are left, yes, but no more wholesale deaths in the Place de la Révolution. I better get back to my bread, but I had to tell you, you are my holiest customers. God has answered our prayers.
Good morning, Father. May I walk with you?
Yes, good morning, Monsieur Pantin.
I was waiting for you. Simone suggested I should accompany you, just to make sure there is no trouble. He gave me his saber. How do I look?
Oh, dangerous. It's a strange feeling to be able to walk in the daylight. We have lived like moles in the darkness for so long.
The moment I woke up this morning, I could tell a cloud had been lifted from Paris. Sister Marguerite, she is well today?
Oh, yes. I've arranged to meet her at Notre Dame. We are both anxious to see whether it remains as it was, hopefully undamaged and undefiled.
Ooh, the Lord, I thought the days of crowds blocking off the streets were over. We cannot go through here.
What is the matter? Why not?
This street leads directly to the scaffold in the Place de la Révolution. Here, Father, if you stand on top of these steps with me, we can have an unobstructed view.
I was praying these executions were no more.
Well, they are practically over. Only the accomplices who sent so many others to their death now will have their turn. Look, the first one is walking up to the scaffold, and behind him, two others.
Who is that? The tall man standing on the scaffold.
The one who is now kneeling?
That man.
He is placing his head on the block. That one?
I know him. Who is he?
Oh, everyone in Paris knows him.
I said mass for him a year ago. And then again this year, 4 days ago.
Who is he? He is the headsman. His hand actuates the guillotine. Father! Help me, someone! The priest has fainted. Stand back, please, so I can plan his face. He needs air. He's an old man, and the sight of another execution was too much for him.
Father, he gave me the handkerchief the king used to wipe his brow
on the way to the end.
His was the heart in the steel blade. Lord, have mercy on his soul.
The irony of Honoré de Balzac's extraordinary portrayal of life in the days of the Reign of Terror is that the very man who triggers the end to so many lives is the only man of conscience and heart. As the author says, poor man, there was a heart in the steel blade at a time when none was found in all of France. I shall return shortly. One of the greatest writers of all times takes his fiction from fact. He is not circumventing or embroidering upon the truth. He is digging deeper. He is making us actually stand on the very street corners of people's lives. The ambition of Honoré de Balzac was to remove the dust and mystery of the past and bring it to life. And I ask you, for the past hour, didn't you live with him under the Reign of Terror? I did. Our cast included Marian Seldes, Arnold Moss, Earl Hammond, and Sam Gray. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
We proposed it to Giraud, and he agreed. Königstein was not hard to enter at night. Just wait and scoot past the sanctuary. Getting out might be a problem. The night of the new moon, Henri and I went over the escape plan for the last time.
Now we look over the edge of the parapet. Once the sentry has passed below us, we have 10 minutes before the next one. Behind this pile of wood is my rope. Tie it around me now, and when I say so, let me down. When I am near the bottom, I will pull the rope as a signal. Hold it out from you so I kick out and clear the moat. All right. It is time. There goes the sentry. No more rehearsals. Now, we do it.
This is E.G. Marshall, inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.